I want to thank everybody again who helped last weekend set up in the park. We had a good time. God was good, right? We had awesome weather. Man, it's ripping hot out there right now, isn't it? But it was perfect out there at the lake. They had a nice breeze. It was awesome. So I just want to thank everybody, not only who came out, but who helped. Last week, remember, I talked to you in detail. I hope you got something from it about, posers. The church is filled with posers that aren't truly Christian, that mark, that your cross or your tattoo or circumcision, that's really not what makes a Christian, that something about you changes and you're real. You know what I mean? And I talked to you, I use it as an example, my car. Remember I was talking to you about the Thunder Road and how that someone put Thunder Road badge on the side of it. And so it's really not a 330 horsepower V8 Hemi engine. I know you probably think that it was, but it's really not. And just because it has a badge, that doesn't mean that it is. It only has like 100 horsepower. Now, I have to say, I looked up online, there's a couple different, I'm not quite sure, it was either 97 horsepower or 123 horsepower, but either way, not much, right? Okay, but listen, for all you people that like to rip on my car, okay, and I know you do, I rode with Tim today, and he's a hater. He is a stinking hater. He doesn't know divine opulence when he sits in it. Amen, okay? So for all you haters out there, I just want to show you something. This was just the other day, cruising down 561, right? Check this out. You know what that car is? Look at that. Whoa, rewind that a second. Hold on. That's a Corvette. You got that right, buddy. 561. No. Started, listen, it started as a split line. It just took a little while to get some speed up. That's all. That is on 561. It took a while to get going there. You're all haters. Jealous. You better, can't you control your woman? Huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah, they TP'd my house. I know where you live. It's okay. It won't nothing will happen to your truck. That's good. Or the boat. Yeah. Huh? Just remember, I don't forget stuff. That's good. I don't forget the important things. Okay, so we're studying the HD gospel, right? So here's the HD gospel. The HD gospel is our opportunity to share the gospel in high definition. It's so that we can understand it. There's a couple of reasons why we do it. It is my hope that you would be able to understand what the gospel really is so that you can, so it can have some value to you, so that you can you can appreciate what Jesus has done for you in a greater way. And if you put some words to this gospel, you can understand what it means to be saved. You know, not just like a Christian where, oh, I'm saved. I'm saved. What does that mean? I don't know. You know, the Bible tells us that we have to be able to give an answer. We need to be able to give an answer for what we believe, our hope. Like, you should know, right? And so if you study this book here, the book of Romans, Paul does it. He breaks it down specifically so you can understand what the gospel is. You can understand the power that has saved you. It teaches us what you're saved from, and it teaches us what you're saved to. Okay? And so that's the first thing, so that you have a clear understanding. So, you know, the Bible also tells us that he wants us to not only be saved, but all of us to come to a full understanding of the truth. He wants you to know all that he has revealed. Like, he doesn't want you, you know, just wandering around wondering what's going on. He wants you to know. Because if you know, you can live with some confidence. And the flip side to that, not the byproduct to that, is that if you really know and you have some value there and you can identify what it really is, you'll be more inclined when Jesus says go, you'll do that because you have an understanding of what it is That the if you understand what the gospel is, you can explain it to somebody. You know what I'm saying? But if you don't really know, you really want to go up and start talking to somebody about something you don't really know? Why is it that public speaking is so rough for people? Why are we so afraid of it? If you really have an understanding of the content, of what you're going to talk about, it takes away a lot of the fear. When you really know what you're talking about, if you feel, even though none of us are really experts, but if you feel like you're sort of an expert in whatever you're talking about, whether it's the gospel, whether it's basketball, whether it's auto mechanics, roofing, whatever it is, how to fix computers, if you know something really well, you can stand up with confidence and share it with somebody. But if you don't know what the gospel is, why would you share it? I don't blame you if you're afraid. I don't blame you if you're afraid. So we want to study the gospel in its entirety so we know what it is. Okay, so I want to introduce you to someone. You won't meet him here, but I'm going to tell you about him. His name is Randy. I have a buddy, Randy, and he was one of my golf buddies. Okay, one of my drinking buddies. Let's just call it what it is, okay? And so Randy, I like Randy. He's a good guy, still around here, but Randy, one day when I became a Christian, he came up to me and he said something to me which was very different than what most people had said to me. See, most people, when I became a Christian, they're waiting to see when Moses would fall off the wagon. You got friends like that, right? Okay, I haven't fallen off yet. It's been 10 years, amen? Okay, so here's the thing. But Randy came up to me and he says, you know, I don't doubt that you're this excited about religion, you know, because everything that you do, since I've known you, I've known him since I think 94. Everything that you do, you just go all in on it. You know, that's just your personality. When I was in the golf business, before I was in the business, I wanted to play. I wanted to be the next Tiger Woods. I mean, everyone wants to be the next Tiger Woods, right? So I played a lot. I practiced a lot. I hit balls, I putt, I chip putt. I was practicing, I was at the golf course all day, all night. That's what I did, I was all in on it. I sucked, and so I couldn't play for a living. Okay, so, but then I got into the rules of golf, right? And on the rules of golf, there is a rule book, it's not quite this thick, it's just a small book, but there's another book called The Decisions of the Rules of Golf, and it has every single particular individual situation that's ever happened on a golf course in the book, so that you know what to make, you know, how to make the ruling. Do you know what I'm saying? It's not a football field. See this perfect rectangle? So you can make rules that are uniform, bless you. It's like that whether you're at the stadium where the Rams play, or you're where the Bills play, or where the Raiders play. It's all the same because it's 100 yards. But at a golf course, it's always different, right? So you have to have all these rules. So what did I do? I wasn't happy to just kind of have an idea of what the rules were. I memorized the book. I literally memorized that entire book, so I knew. That's just what I was doing. And then I got out of that, and I got into the car business, and I had this just undying drive to be the best at that store, to sell as much as I could. And so, and Kenny will tell you, I was there all the time. I worked a ton. I was aggressive taking customers. I wouldn't relent. Like, I wanted to be on top of that board. I wanted to make the most money. I wanted to be really good at it. And so I gave it a lot of time, a lot of effort. That's just my nature. It's just the way I am. And when I wanted to be a sinner, I was all in on that. Right? I didn't just have a few drinks. I drank with a purpose. I was an earnest drinker. I didn't smoke a few cigarettes a day, man. You got to hammer them down. If you're going to do it, let's do it right. You know what I'm saying? If you're going to chase girls around, let's get them. I was all in on my sin. That's just the way I was. But back in like 2000, when 2003 is turning into 2004, the Lord grabbed a hold of my heart and took that man that he had made that was excited about whatever he was into, and he took that passion that was inside of me for whatever I was into, and he redirected it completely on him. That's what he did. So I'm no different than I was back then. I just wasn't chasing Jesus. Now I'm chasing Jesus, and and what happened immediately is I had an insatiable appetite for this Jesus. And That's just who I am by nature. See, we all have a gift. We're all a certain way. That's the way we're built, right? And so my way is to just pursue whatever it is that's in front of me. I set my mind to it. That's what I want. And a lot of you guys will make fun of me, and you'll rip me and stuff like that because I get ahead of myself around here. That's just my nature. You know what I told Tim? I love Tim. You know why I love Tim? Okay, we changed the bulbs in these chandeliers today. He's on a 14-foot ladder that had more termites than wood in it. And he's climbing up on this thing. And it's got, you know, the metal things that hold it from going like this? One of them works. Right? The other one, we put a nail in it and bent it. And the one that works has a rivet that's covered in rust. It could have snapped like that in a second. Sorry, Jess. Right? Why would he? You know what? See, I didn't tell you this part. We ordered new globes. Okay, they're coming next week. Going back up. He won't do it on that ladder again. We already talked about it. But like, why would we do that today? Because he's impatient, and I love that guy. Because he wanted better lighting today. Not even as good as it's going to be next week, but better than it was last week. Right? You want to do the dimmer just so they can see it? Come on. Ooh. Ah. That was worth it all right there. Tim could have died, but it was worth it. Yeah. Sorry. Don't let him hang out with me. That's just who I am. So now here's I think one of the reasons why I have this insatiable appetite for Jesus and just God in general. I wish I thought about this earlier. I should have grabbed my Bible. It's sitting there on my desk, my old one, that's literally falling apart. Like I have to put a rubber band around it to hold it together because I tore into that thing like a T-Rex. And I think one of the reasons why I did is because the truth of who God is was suppressed in my life for 30 plus years. I was not allowed to know the truth. I was not introduced to the truth. That won't open, Paula. That won't open. This building is so old, it's so warped that you have to kick that door to open it now. Okay. So the truth of who God was suppressed in my life. My parents didn't allow it. Okay. And so when all of a sudden the can was opened, man, it was like on. Like, what? Are you kidding me? I can eat cheeseburgers? Woo! That was enough. And so I like start to tear into this thing. And so I've learned so much about who God is, and it's exciting. But I have to tell you that there's a lot of things about God that I had. Like, I had questions right away. And I've been just like after him for over 10 years now, and some of those questions I still have. We talked about it this morning, me and Jessica and Tim, about some of the things that I have no idea, okay? And we're about to get to them right now. And Romans chapter 3 is scary. It is scary. I had questions, and I'm going to throw these questions out to you, and then we're going to jump into our Bibles. And you don't need to answer, but I want you to be thinking about these things. I had questions about this save thing, right? I was a Jewish guy. So we had temple, we believed in God, we had 10 commandments, all that, you know, be good and all that. But saved? What is that? What's saved mean? What are you saving me from, dude? I'm good. We got food, right? Got a decent house, got a car, air conditioning. What are you saving me from? Who gets saved? How do they get saved? So you have to be a Christian or everyone else goes to hell? What kind of God is that? Who is this God? What if they, here's a big one. What if they never hear the gospel? Anyone ever asked that question? What about the dude in the cave in New Guinea who never hears the name of Jesus? What happens to him? What happens to Jackson if he perishes today? See, no one wants to really think about that, but I can't help it. I have an appetite. So I've been studying and praying and reading commentaries and Googling stuff and looking it up, and I've been doing this for 10 years, and that's why I didn't want to preach this book. Because I'm telling you right now, I don't have the answers to all those things. I don't have the answers to all those things. We're going to pursue it together. But I'm going to tell you right now, you're probably, the next 2 to 3 weeks, it's going to be freaky. And you may hear some things that you disagree with. I'm going to do the best that I can to rightly divide that word so that you can understand it. But if you think you've walked into the church where Charles Stanley's standing up here and saying, "Thus saith the Lord," you came to the wrong house, yo, because that's not me. I have a lot of questions still, and I've been already going through Romans 3 way past tonight. There's probably going to be some times that I'm going to ask you to break off into groups, and we're going to start praying, and we're going to start asking God for an answer to something that I don't know, so maybe we can get some clarity. So it might not be church as usual, so just be ready for that. Is that cool? All right. Our text tonight will be, we've gone through chapters 1 and 2. We're going to start in chapter 3. We're going to read the first 4 verses. We'll jump down. We'll read a couple later on in the chapter, further on down. But anyway, Romans chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. One of the questions that I'd like to help you answer is a question that I've had for a long time, and it was on the opening video, which is, what is a person's condition or position outside of the gospel? Before the gospel invades your life, what condition are you in? How do you stand with God? Okay, so what we're going to try to do, and I think Paul has done this really well in this letter, a letter to a church in Rome that started with a bunch of Jewish folks that were at Pentecost. They got saved, right? They went back to Rome, to the heart of the enemy, and they started a church, and all these Gentiles, these Greeks and Romans, they started joining the church. And so he's writing to all of these people, but all these people, much like here in Florida, they all bring something different to the table. I love this book, and I love where we live, because they go hand in hand. Nowhere else in this country do you get this type of melting pot. Everyone moves to Florida from different parts of the country, and so we all have different backgrounds and traditions and religions. We all have different amounts of money in the bank. We have different practices. Our family does things. My family does things. You'd probably go, "What in the world?" And you guys eat like raccoons and frogs and all that kind of sick stuff. And Dan's drooling over there. Look at him. Ugh. You're all a bunch of whack jobs, right? Everybody's different. Right? And so that's what's happening in Rome. And Paul writes this letter to try, like I said, to rope it in so we can all get on the same page. We all have different backgrounds. Okay, so this is the thing that's amazing about the church. Jesus Christ, I've said this before, this thing drives me. This statement of Jesus drives me. I love it. It's in Matthew 16, 18, and Jesus says something different. It's different. Before, it was all these different nations and people groups, and they all had their own gods, and they were happy with that. But Jesus comes along, Matthew 16, 18, he says, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So he stands up and he proclaims to 12 men way overseas 2,000 years ago that this is going to happen today. That's crazy, right? And here you are, proof that he's right. 2,000 years later in Eustis, you're sitting in this building worshiping as part of his church. Now, what is the church? The church is his people. Bottom line, the church is his people, whether they were Jew, whether they were Gentile, who, no matter who it was, Jesus was doing something different. He was bringing people in from all corners of the earth, all different walks of life, all different religions, all different backgrounds, different traditions, different practices, different age, different sex, different everything, and he's bringing them all together, his people. And this is what he's going to do to build his church. He's going to have more people conformed into his image. That's the Father's desire. In Romans, it says that. Romans 8, that God's desire is that we would become more like Jesus. So more and more people becoming conformed into the image of Jesus the Son, we will rule and we will reign alongside of Jesus, who is the King of this kingdom. That's what Jesus is going to do, roping them all in from all walks of life across the earth, not satisfied any longer with saying, bless you, Everyone say bless you to Jared. Oh yeah, you're covered now for the rest of the night. Okay, so do you want us to put orange? Should we put orange? Let's put orange lights on for Jared. Okay, I don't know what's wrong with me. Okay, just bear with me. I haven't had enough coffee. This water's not cutting it. Okay, so where was I? Okay, so he's bringing everybody in from all across the world and under this one umbrella called his church. Now, this kingdom that he's going to build is quite different than the traditional kingdom. The traditional kingdom, as you look in history, is what? More land, right? More land, definitely more people, but more land, more resources, right? More gold, more silver, conquer that hill. That's the normal kingdom, okay? But this kingdom, you have to have a different mindset, okay? It's a little bit different, all right? It's a little bit different. What he's going to do in his church is he's going to strengthen those that are already in it so that they can bless him and make him happy. He's loving that when they become more like his son. But the byproduct of that is that we will go out following his commission to go make more disciples so they can be more like Jesus and his kingdom would grow. So those that are in are strengthened. Why? To please God and to go reach more people. Are we tracking? Okay, that's what he wants to do. But it's a totally different mindset. It's different than it was ever before with any other people group. Like I said, all these different people groups had different gods that they worshiped. Some of them were polytheists. They had several gods, the god of the sun, the god of the sky, the god of the harvest, the god of this, the god of that. But Jesus is like, no. One God for all people. Look over in Romans chapter 3, verse 29. Total mindset. This is totally different. It's a new thing. He says this. Now, remember this. Now, this God, this Yahweh God, okay, he was the king. He was the God of the Hebrews, right? He was the God of the Hebrews. And many Hebrews felt like that he didn't own them, but that they owned him. He was their God. Don't step on my God. You get your own God. He's the God of the Hebrews. But what does it say here? After all, is God the God of the Jews only? Isn't he also the God of the Gentiles? Of course he is. There is only one God. There's only one God. So I think it's safe to assume here that God wants the worship of every single person on earth. Now, see, we know that because when we look back into Genesis, it says that he created man and woman to be like him in his image. He didn't just say, let's just make the Jewish people like me and the rest of these heathens, they're just going to do their own thing. He made all people in his image. You got that? So he didn't just make them and then cut them loose to go do their own thing. He made them like him. He wants them to worship him. And now, in the person of Jesus Christ, he's bringing it all together as one God with one body. So we saw, as we study through chapter 1, it makes it very, very clear that every single person on earth is well aware of God. Everyone knows he exists, okay? We saw that. We saw that everyone knows that he exists, but yet some people don't give a rip. We know that. We also know that everyone knows he exists, and some people do care, but they won't follow him the way he says to follow them. So they make up these wacky religions, remember? Remember we went over those? Nwambianism, remember that one? Some people will not follow him, and some people will. You don't need to turn there, but in the book of Ephesians, Paul, the same guy who wrote Romans, tells us in chapter 4 this, that there is one faith, there is one baptism, there is one God and Father who is over and in all. There is one God, and he wants the worship of every single person on earth. And that is what he has begun to do in the person of Jesus Christ, to bring people from all walks of life and all religions under this one umbrella of Christianity. I'm going to read you a verse that I think kind of sums it all up for us. You can do me a favor. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 10, way back. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 14. Don't cut yourself short here. Don't just trust me. Read your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, just open up one of these orange or yellow ones, and you can take it home with you and make it your own if you want. Okay, Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 14. This is what it says. Look, the highest heavens and the earth and everything in it all belong to the Lord your God. Not just like the sky like outside that window, but the heavens and the heavens above that and as far as we can't see. Everything as far as there is and everything here on earth belongs to him. Now we know from the Ten Commandments that because of that, he said, because of this, I'm God only. And do not put any other gods before me. I'm it. You worship me. Okay? You worship me. See, he owns everything. So his your worship is due to who? Him, right? It's not due to anybody else. It's due to him and him alone. Now, responses to this truth may vary, but truth doesn't. Okay? Truth doesn't vary. You know, my little girl, Jameson, and we all love her. She's cute and everything, but she's a sassy little thing. And so my little wubby, she's a fresh little sinner, okay? So she's got this thing now, like, you know, I mean, like, this. She didn't start the no thing. Like, all of us did it, too. No! Now this is a new one. Go away! You got that one, right? Mimi gets that all the time. You know what she got that? This is scary. She got that from The Little Mermaid. All that nice little Disney stuff that we let our kids watch. Ariel says, go away. And so now my little cute little two-year-old little girl, go away. And then her new one is, I'm the boss. Yeah? How about we don't feed you anymore? We'll see who the boss is, right? You're the boss? Why don't you get in the car and drive to the store? Who's the boss? I'm the boss. See, she doesn't understand that, you know, like, daddy and mommy, we're king and queen, right? See, her response may be different, but the truth is that mommy and daddy are queen in the house. Okay, and we're the same rebellious little punk kids to God. Like, our opinion may vary. Our response to what we heard about God owning it all and wanting all your worship, it may vary, but it doesn't take away from the truth. I'm daddy, Wubby, and you're not. Do you understand? And see, that's the way God wants us to understand. Romans 2:11 tells us that there's no favoritism. He doesn't like Jewish people more than he likes Gentiles. He doesn't like Gentiles more than he likes Jewish people. He doesn't like German people more than he likes Russian people. He doesn't like Puerto Rican people more than he likes French people. He doesn't like old people more than he likes young people. Black, white, purple, male, female, young, old. It doesn't make a difference. God shows no favoritism that we are all, in his eyes, one people. We're one people. Do you understand? See, once you're in, once you're part of the kingdom of God, which is his people. See, he's building a kingdom, and it's not take that hill and take that hill. It's take this soul and get this soul and get that soul. He's gathering up people to worship him. He's gathering up his soldiers to worship him, right? That's what he's trying to do. And once you're in that family, once you're in that army, there's no difference at all who you are. The Bible tells us in Colossians 3:11 that in this new life, that it doesn't, and I'm going to extend it a little bit. I'm going to blow out the runway a little bit more than what it really says, but he says that in this new life, it doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile. It doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. It doesn't matter if you're black or white. It doesn't matter if you're well-mannered or you're a barbarian or whether you're a slave or whether you're free. It doesn't make any difference who you were. We're all one in Christ. That's what it says. He's building his church. In verse 15 of that same chapter, it says that we are all members of one body. That body, the body of Christ, that is the kingdom of God. It's not something that's coming. It's something you're sitting in right now. This is the kingdom of God, right here, You are the kingdom of God. Right here on earth, you are the presence of Jesus Christ the Lord. Right here. You're part of the body of Christ. You're the bride of Christ. You're the body of Christ. One family, one body. He said in John 10:16, I believe it is, that his desire that there be one body with one shepherd, one flock with one shepherd. That's what God is doing. Now, but our text here tonight in Romans chapter 3, starting here in verse 1, it sort of flies in the face of everything that I hope that you've now accepted as truth that we just shared. It kind of flies in the face of it. Why don't we read it and I'll elaborate a little bit. Okay, Romans chapter 3. Then, what's the advantage of being a Jew? Is there any value in the ceremony of circumcision? Yes, there are great benefits. Exclamation point. So it must be big, right? It must be a big deal. It's a big deal to be a Jew. It's a big deal. It's not a big deal to have been circumcised, to have your foreskin removed, but the significance of it, the meaning behind it, to actually say you were one of these Jewish people, that's a big deal. Why? Is it because, like, we're better? Is it because in Sharon, we're the chosen people, and you're not? And so I'm special, and you're dogs. Is that what it is? Is there any benefit then? Well, yes, there are great benefits. First of all, the Jews were entrusted with the whole revelation of God. The whole revelation of God. Let's talk about the revelation of God. Many people believe that the revelation of God, the whole revelation of God, is this. You don't have to show your hands, but do you believe that? That's the revelation of God. This is everything that God wants you to know right here. That's what people say. The whole revelation of God is the canon of Scripture. It closed 2,000 years ago. It's done. This is it. I would beg to differ. I beg to differ. I think that the whole revelation of God is both the written word of God that tells us about the Lord. It's also a lot of oral tradition. See, the Jewish people, before this Bible was written, you know, you guys have it now. You got a copy. You got a copy. It's easy. You go to Walmart, get it for $4. Yeah, but they didn't have printing presses back then, right? So a lot of the stories of what God had done, you'd tell your kids. I'd tell my kids. It wasn't even in written form yet. As a matter of fact, over in Deuteronomy chapter 6, it tells us this. It says to tell your children about me every day, no matter what you're doing. It says whether you're at home or whether you're away, whether you're in bed or whether you're up, whether you're at work or whatever, tell your kids about me all the time. Not this. Tell them what I've done. Do you understand what I'm saying? So there's more than just the Bible. The whole revelation of God is not just the Bible. It's God saying, listen, I have done a lot of stuff. I have revealed myself to you in amazing ways. So is there an advantage to being a Jew? Yeah, like he chose to show off in front of and in your benefit. Of all the nations of the earth, he chose all the greatest stories in history were done right before the eyes of the Jewish people. Not only did they see it, but they just weren't, you know, bystanders watching this stuff. They were actively involved, part of what God was doing. They were privy to this stuff. That's the revelation of God, where he said, listen, this is who I am. And come and witness what I've done and who I am. And I will bless and I will help you. I'll deliver you. I'll do supernatural things before you. And they got to be part of that, these Jewish people. It started way, way back. You know, like in the Garden of Eden? What happened? They're naked and ashamed. What happened? God clothed them. That's crazy, right? He clothed them. And how about when the children of Israel are in Egypt and they cried out to the Lord? What does the scripture say? That he heard their cry and he sent Moses and Aaron. Where's my man Aaron? Right there. He sent us to go deliver the nation of Israel from Egypt. And then those same stubborn, rebellious idolaters, these Israelites, when they're in the desert and the Red Sea before them and chariots behind them, definite death, and they cry out, and what happens? God opens the Red Sea, so, and they see this, I would, can you imagine Lake Eustis all of a sudden, instead of the waves coming in like this, they're going like this. I'd poop myself right there. And they got to see that, right, and walk through the lake. Can you imagine walking through there? Whoa, right, the walls. They got to be part of that. They witnessed it. They lived it. They weren't just told about it. They got to live it, these Jewish people. It's the story of Gideon when he's got 300 soldiers. Not much. Basically 300 times what we're sitting in right now. Three times what we're sitting in right now. And he goes to fight the enemy. Now, I wasn't there. But the Bible describes the enemy as a swarm of locusts. Who's driven down Lakeshore Drive when there's a hatch? Oi. Right? And you see the light, and you see 10 billion of those blind mosquitoes right here, right? That's what the Bible describes the soldiers as. A swarm of locusts. Now, they didn't have tanks, and they didn't have jeeps and all that kind of stuff back then. So their fighting horses were camels. The same text says that there was as many camels as grains of sand on the seashore. This is a large army that 300 guys are going to go try to fight. And God says, Gideon, when you go fight them, it's going to be as if you're fighting one man. Gideon was probably going, yeah, whatever. Whatever, right? So what happens? Gideon's like, charge, wait, hold on. God made the enemy start killing each other. They start hacking. Before a single sword is pulled out to fight, they pulled out their own swords, this enemy, and started killing each other, wiped out. Can you imagine this? Being there, watching this all go down? It's the same revelation. This revelation of God is Daniel chapter 1. The mighty king Nebuchadnezzar, he builds a 90, he was a little bald dude, is what history tells us. Okay? A little bald guy. And he wanted worship. And so he had built a 90-foot golden statue of him. And everyone was told that when the music plays, everyone in the land must worship, bow down to this statue of me. And these three Jewish guys, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, better known as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they say, no, I will not bow down to any god other than the God. And so they take these three guys and they throw them into a boiler. Think about the trains that used to have coal, right? Red hot, throw some more coal in there. And they threw these dudes into a furnace like that. And what happens? You read the story, and God shows up in the form of a man, and he looked like Jesus, and he protects them. And they come out of the furnace, and they're not even burnt. And the text says that they didn't even smell like smoke. That's God. That's God. And they got to be part of it. It's the revelation that's shown in the book of Nehemiah. When Nehemiah, the Jew, is under the rule and reign of King Xerxes, the mighty Persian sick killer king. And they have come into Jerusalem. They have destroyed the city. The wall around Jerusalem is destroyed. And they're being, the Jewish people are being suppressed and oppressed. And it's terrible, much like the Roman Empire. So what does Nehemiah do? Nehemiah, man, this guy's got a spine. He prays. He says, God, grant me favor with this king. So what does Nehemiah do? Now think about this for a second. Nehemiah represents the Jews, the enemy of Persia. Persia, the enemy of the Israelites, right? Persia comes in, conquers the Israelites, and destroys all that they have, so they can't rebel. If your infrastructure is done, you have no choice. You can't rebel, right? So what does Nehemiah do? God, grant me favor with this guy. Watch what I'm going to go ask him. Hey, Nebuchadnezzar, I want to rebuild the nation that will oppose you Would that be okay? Say yes. Yeah. Oh, by the way, will you give me all the supplies to do it? Yeah, that's what happened. I mean, just think about that for a second. I don't even know who our great, but imagine if in World War II, we just went over to Nazi Germany and said, hey, Adolf, we're going to rebel against you. We're going to fight you. We're going to conquer you. And would you do me a favor? Would you give me the tanks and bullets so that I can? Sure. Yeah, let's do that. And see, that's what Nehemiah did. And the text in Nehemiah 2:8 says this, that the king granted all of Nehemiah's requests. Why? Because the gracious hand of God was on me. That's why he did it. When there was famine in the land and drought and no one could eat or drink, Elijah's there, the man of God with no food and no drink. What does he do? What would you do? God commanded the ravens, the blackbirds. Y'all see blackbird out there? He commanded the ravens to bring Elijah bread and meat every morning. And they listened. I mean, see, come on, right? I mean, can you imagine being part of this? I'm lucky, like, if I get out of a speeding ticket. I'm lucky if something's broken and I hit it and it starts working again. I'm like, woo! The photocopy machine, it is Lucifer. Okay? And it's moody and I won't say anything. It's moody and it doesn't work. And so we have a little printer in the office. And so now we're having to use that one. And I'm going to roll that thing out to the curb. So yesterday I got back here to the church, and I wanted to run off these lists of the Eustis Middle School supplies that you guys are all going to pick up and take with you and fill up the stage with next weekend, right? And so the printer won't work. I punched it. And I told Kyle that I punched it, and I didn't understand how it worked, why it didn't work. He said, I don't understand either, because I fixed a lot of perfectly good walls back in my day with that same approach. I threw it in the dumpster, and as I was walking out, I clicked on that photocopy machine, and it worked. Lucifer. It's the same God. We're talking about the revelation of God, God revealing himself to his people. So you can bear witness to all this. It's the same God when Daniel refuses to bow down also, and the king has him thrown into a lion's den. These weren't, what are they called, Siegfried and Roy? That's not these lions. These are killers, right? Untrained, out in the bush, rip your guts apart and eat you lions. And he throws them into the lion's den. And what does the text say? That God closed the mouths of the lions. This is who we're talking about here. We're talking about beyond the scriptures. Do you guys know the story of Hanukkah? You know Hanukkah is the Jewish Christmas, right? You know what I'm talking about? I was very, very deprived while you guys were singing Christmas carols and ho, ho, ho and all that nice stuff. I was spinning dreidels. Don't laugh. I'm still hurting. You pray for me. Dreidel, dreidel, dreidel. Adam Sandler, look it up. If you say I look like him, I'll come to your house. Okay, so listen. So this is what the story is, right? The story is this, is that in a temple, like, let's just pretend this is Temple Adath Sharon back in where I live. Here, there's an ark. No drum set there. Go figure. This is an ark with the Torahs in it, and above the ark, like, I don't know, kind of like where the projector is back there, there's this little light. Now, back in the day, back in the Bible days, they didn't have electricity, obviously. Right? So they would use oil. So there was only enough oil. Let me just say this. The light, the eternal light is what they call it. The eternal light is the presence of God amongst his people. Like, if that light goes out, that's a bad thing. You know what I'm saying? That's a bad thing. I wonder about that now because they have, like, bulbs. Like, what happens when they change the bulb? Does he, like, leave for a minute and come back? I don't know. Right? So I like the whole Holy Spirit thing because I don't like the bulb thing. That's not a good thing, okay? So this is the thing. They had oil back then, and they only had enough oil to last one day. And the nation of Israel was at war. It's the time of the Maccabees. And the nation of Israel was at war, and they couldn't get the oil to the temple, and that light was going out. And they wouldn't be able to get back for 8 days. But that oil, supernaturally, lasted. Go figure. I don't know. This is just God. And so God reveals himself in an extremely powerful way to the Jew. So is there an advantage to being a Jew? Yeah, you get the whole revelation of God. You got to live this stuff out firsthand, right before your face, involved with the miracles. You're part of them. And there were other people across the other sides of the earth. They knew nothing about this. They saw the sun come up. They saw the sun go down. They saw the natural beauty. But they weren't watching the Red Sea open up. They weren't hearing the thunder and lightning and over the Mount Sinai and a voice coming down. Who was hearing that stuff? The Jews. Who had the burning bush? The Jews. Right? They were privy to all this kind of stuff. Do me a favor. I hope you have your finger still in Deuteronomy. Go back there. Deuteronomy chapter 4. This tells us about the full revelation of God. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 32. Tell me when you're there. I'm having fun tonight. This is cool. Thank you for letting me do this. Okay, so here's what God says. Now search all of history from the time God created people on the earth until now. Now what is that? That's from day six, right? That's old. From day six to the time this is being written, search every person in every situation and search one end of the heavens to the other. Has anything as great as this ever been seen or heard before? Has any nation ever heard the voice of God speaking from the fire as you did and survived? You know, the Bible calls God a consuming fire. To look at him, you would die. Verse 34, has any other God dared to take a nation for himself out of another nation by means of trials, miraculous signs, wonders, war, a strong hand and a powerful arm, and terrifying acts? The 10 plagues. They're sitting around, and all of a sudden, locusts and frogs and fleas and hail, like the Nile turns to blood, and they're watching all this stuff go down, right? Is there an advantage to seeing this? All other people in the world, they just have to try to seek him out through creation. And these people are watching the Nile River turn to blood with their own eyes. Read on. Yet that is what the Lord your God did for you in Egypt, right before your eyes. He showed you these things so you would know that the Lord is God and there is no other. You see, he leaves no room for worshiping anything else. He let you hear his voice from heaven so he could instruct you. He let you see his great fire here on earth so he could speak to you from it. Because he loved your ancestors, he chose to bless their descendants, and he personally brought you out of Egypt with a great display of power. Look at verse 39. So remember this and keep it firmly in mind. The Lord is God both in heaven and on earth, and there is no other. Okay, that was good preaching right there. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, okay? Okay, so here's the thing. What is there an advantage to being a Jew? Yeah, there's a huge advantage to being a Jew. He revealed himself to a people. He said, this is who I am, this is what I do, and this is what I want, this is how I want you to live. And all this amazing stuff is done right before and on behalf of these Jewish people, and they have now shared all that I've just described to you and much, much more, generation after generation to the children, so that they, what? Would know that he is God. That's the only reason, that he is God, not us. And it is not so that we could open this up and memorize a text. But it's intended to remind his people of a God that loves and hears and delivers his people. That is what the whole revelation of God is all about. So that you know that he loves you. So that you know that he hears you. And that you know that he will act powerfully for his people. Do you know in Romans 11, I love this. It says that he will do things contrary to nature to help his people. Contrary to nature. You can throw physics out the window when it comes to God. If you don't like this earth, he'll make a new one. You know what I'm saying? If he look, in Joshua it says that he made the sun stand still. We know now, I think, that our earth spins. So at very least, he's a slacker. He made the earth stand still. Earth schmirth. Right? He made the sun what I'm telling you is that you have to open up your mind to the crazy possibilities of what God will and can do for you. How many people have had the need, this incredible need for God to deliver them in their life, whatever it is, financial, relational, job, whatever, and all of a sudden, boom, here comes the check. Woo! Where'd that come from, right? So what do we do? What do we do? We start thinking, well, that's the way he does it. That's the way he does it. That's the way he does it. I need something. That's the way you do it. And then wham, he comes in from here. Woo! And you think, well, then that's where it comes from. And then whoa, he comes in from here. We think we know what God will do. And he'll do things contrary to nature to deliver his people. You got to start opening up your mind to what God would do. Open it up to the possibilities of what God would do. So the benefit to knowing all this back then, even now. But back then, you had a bunch of Jewish Christians, right? You had a bunch of Jewish Christians that they had the Old Testament written down, and they had their parents and grandparents and great-grandparents handing down generation after generation, telling them all these stories, a lot more than what I just shared with you. And this Bible ain't even sniffing it. You know, in the book of John, John's like, yeah, I wrote down some of the stuff that Jesus did. Like, I didn't write down all of it. I'd run out of room on this earth, but enough just so you'll believe. It's the same thing with the whole Bible. Like, there's some in here. Yeah, some. It's enough. And so these people are handing these stories down generation after generation so that they can believe, because they're going to be faced with a variety of different situations. There's going to be adversity, much like we have, and they're going to need to be reminded of God's sovereignty and his willingness to deliver his people. So they can look back at this thick and rich history of God's powerful hand for his people. And it'll gird up their faith. That's why he does it. That's why we pass on generation after generation what God did. So that our faith can be strong. All this power that you see, that I share with you of what God would do, it's revealed to us. Why? To remind us of our inability. And to also, at the same time, while it's reminding you that you can't do anything, it's also reminding you of his availability. That's what it's doing. That's what the whole revelation of God is all about. And this revelation, this knowing all that God has done, who hears, he loves, he acts, he delivers, it helps us with an all-too-common problem. See, the sinful, rebellious heart, that sinful nature inside of us defaults to earning righteousness, to thinking we can do things, to earning righteousness, performance righteousness, good deeds righteousness. It's this Jewish thing that's holding on to us that says if we'll just keep the laws, we're good. And it's this Gentile thing also that just says, hey, the subjective conscience, if we'll just follow that, we'll be fine. I shared a story last week, I think it was, the week before. I think it was at Round Table on Sunday nights. It's funny, this conscience thing, this subjective conscience that people say, well, you know, I'm a good person. So I work at the gym at my housing development, you know. And there's this guy, this behemoth of a man. He comes walking in like this, right? How you doing? He's got the beard, you know. He looks like, I don't know, like a Viking almost, you know. And he comes walking in, and I'm sitting there, and I'm reading my Bible and stuff, because that's what I do. I'm holy. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm reading my Bible. I'm reading my Bible, and I'm you know, just learning some stuff. And he comes walking, and every day he comes in. He sees me reading my Bible, but he doesn't care, man. Like, he's dropping F-bombs and MF this, and he don't care, right? Like, even when I was, like, wretched, like, if I knew, like, if I was around, a priest or something, or a religious person, you know, you kind of turn it off. Most of you? None of you? Okay, great. Okay, so, but this guy, he doesn't care, right? He doesn't care. So, like, a couple weeks ago, I'm sitting there, and I'm reading my Bible, and he comes walking in, and I'm like, man, how you doing today? And I can't tell you exactly what he said, you know, but it was, you know, had some words in there, but not too, you know, fire truck good. And so, you know, I'm like, well, why? What's wrong? He's like, man, I just went out last night, and man, I just got tore up. And then, you know, of course, this girl asked me back to her house, and you know, you can't say no to that, so you got to go to that. I'm like, dude, do you see me sitting here studying my Bible, right? What are you doing? But I asked him. I said, let me ask you a question. You see me reading this Bible here every day. So when are we having our Jesus talk? Because we're going to have it. And he's like, as soon as I want to. I was like, okay. I said, well, why won't you? He said, well, I think the Bible is BS. He used the real words. I can appreciate that. I can understand. It's fine. Fine. I said, well, how do you live? What's your thing? You know, what's your shtick? And he's like, well, you know, I try to keep good morals. I try to live by my conscience. And I'm like, right? I don't even have to go on anymore. Like, you're catching me, right? Like, so that's not going to work, right? That's just not going to work. I mean, there would be anarchy, right? There's got to be some kind of standard. But apparently having a good conscience means getting tore up, cussing like a sailor, and sleeping with whoever you want. So forget everything I told you. Have a nice night. All right, let's go home. No, I mean, that's just the way he is, you know? So it's just not going to work. It's just not going to work. Full revelation tells us that keeping the rules just isn't going to make you right with God. It's just not going to make you right with God. You know, there were people in the Bible, these Pharisees, the ones that were running the Jewish faith, if you will, back when Jesus was around, they followed the letter of the law. They nailed it perfectly. And what did Jesus even say to that? If you want to be in on my kingdom, your righteousness even has to be better than perfect. Keeping the law won't work. And we also know that following moral conscience, that's not going to make us right with God either. See, full revelation reminds us that deliverance from life's biggest concerns, that deliverance always came from God. And it's always going to. Here's the thing. Is there any advantage to being a Jew? Yes, they saw all that. They heard about all that. But the thing is, now, so have you. You can hate me, because I just put a bunch of judgment on top of your heads. But you know. See, you know. You can't say, oh man, I didn't know that God did that for Nehemiah. I mean, I didn't know that Daniel went to the lion's den and they didn't eat him. Who's the Shadrach guy? Sounds like he plays for the Lakers or something. Like, who is that guy? Like, you know now. So like, when he says, is there any advantage to being a Jew? Yeah. You're all Jews, because you now know. Because it says here in, I think it was chapter 2, it said it doesn't matter. You're not a real Jew if you're born into a Jewish family. You're a real Jew if your heart is right with God. See, I just told you about the revelation of God. I told you what God did for his people that he loves, that he hears, and he delivers. You guys all know. You guys all know. So let me ask you this. What's the biggest concern in a human being's life then? Can I offer this? Sin and its consequences? Would you guys, don't be all holy on me. Would you agree? Sin and the consequence of sin is the biggest problem, because you can live 80 years here and spend an eternity in the fiery furnace. So really, this time here is short compared. So the biggest concern is sin and its consequence. So let's I'm going to leave you hanging tonight. Usually, you know, you preach and you get to a point and you drive it home, and that's not happening here. If the biggest problem is our sin and our consequence, look at Romans chapter 3, verse 9 and 10. Well then, should we conclude that we Jews are better than others? See, I love that word. It's no, we're not better. We may have been better off because we saw what happened. Because our grandma and grandpa told us what happened, so we knew. So we could make a decision, but we weren't better. Keeping laws doesn't make you better, but here's the thing. Now you know. Now you know. Should we conclude that we Jews are better than others? No, not at all. For we have already shown that all people, whether Jews or Greeks or Gentiles, are under the power of sin. As the scriptures say, no one is righteous, not even one. What this is telling us is that no matter what religion you were, no matter what city you were born and raised, no matter what traditions your family kept, no matter how good-natured you are, no matter how many old ladies you put your jacket down on the road for, no matter how much you donate to Red Cross, and whether you quit smoking, quit drinking, stop chasing, stop lying, all that kind of stuff, it doesn't matter. That no one is righteous, not even one. It didn't matter how many rules you kept, it's not going to cut it. It doesn't matter if you followed your conscience, it's not going to cut it. Because every single one of us is under the power of sin. And so what this tells me, and I don't know if it tells you this, is that we're in need of a Savior. Like, imagine for a minute if I kept every single moral law there was. What would you say? He's a good guy, right? That's what we'd call a guy who does good. He's a good guy. Well, the Bible just said that's not going to cut it. That we need something to happen that is outside of ourselves to help us. So what this is telling us is that the condition of every single person on earth without God's intervention is utterly hopeless. And I leave you with that. We'll pray. We'll take communion. I don't know where Kelly is, but we'll pray. All right, I think he's probably helping Wendy. Lord, I thank you for being a straightforward God. I guess I'd be negligent if I didn't thank you personally for allowing me the privilege of being a Jew. I grew up hearing these stories of your power. I heard of the 10 plagues. I heard of Esther. I heard of Ruth. I heard of Mordecai. I heard all these crazy stories. So I was privy to your power. Lord, I thank you that you have made yourself known to all of us. Maybe tonight was the most someone in this room has ever heard of the old stories of your power that you displayed before and for your people. Oh, let us treasure your stories. Let us be moms and dads and friends and mentors who do what your scripture says, and that is to tell of your great deeds before all men. Whether we're at home or we're at work, whether we're getting ready to lie down or whether we're getting ready to get up, let us remember your stories. Let us remember your power and share it with those who would listen. Lord, Lord, I thank you for the Word of God. The Word of God that is so precious and beautiful, and I'm just going to say this, tasty. It tastes so good. And I pray, not right now, Father, I pray over every person in here that you would birth supernaturally, and I don't know how you do it, but that you would birth in every person here a tremendous, insatiable new appetite for the Word of God. That you would make them drawn to the Word of God, and that they would find it a treasure. That your commands, that your Word would be a treasure to them. That they would look forward every day to waking up or coming home from work and spending time on their favorite chair with your Word. And that you would teach us things. That you would strengthen our faith as we reflect back on just how powerful you are. And to know that you are a God that listens, that you are a God that loves, and that you're a God that leads, and you're a God that delivers your people. I thank you for being that God. And Lord, I pray for that God to show up here in this church and in this community, Lord. I pray that you do great things for your people here in the city of Eustis, that you do great things just like you did before. You're the same God yesterday, today, and forever. The things you did then, you can do now. And we would love to share these great stories. And we'd love to be part of your great work here in this community. Show yourself strong, Lord God. Show yourself strong here in our midst, that we might give you the fame, that we might give you the credit for it, that we might share you with anyone who would listen. Do great things beyond our words, Lord, that they cannot deny when they see. Let the seas open. Let the bushes burn. Let the walls tumble. Let the walls go back up that need to go up, all because of you, Lord. Show off amongst your people, Lord. Show off amongst your people. I thank you, Lord. Lord, once again, I just want to thank you for the blessing that was Pat Engledal. Lord, we thank you for the time we got to spend with her. And we look forward to just reflecting back on our friendship and our time with her. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to pray like she did, without ceasing, with faith, to believe that you would deliver. Lord, thank you for the example that she set. Although physically she was just a wreck all the time, her spirit was strong and it glowed and it shined. No matter how much she limped, no matter how much she had trouble talking, she just loved you. And I thank you for that, Lord. And I just need some more. I need some more of that in me. Who needs some more of that? I need some more of that. We all do. So, Lord, we just thank you for her. And we just ask for your blessing on our time here, Lord. And as we get together to take communion, Lord, I just pray you'll bless it. And so, Lord, I don't even know. Guys, whoever's coming, please give this out. Please give it out. And we're going to start to worship again in music. And then when we get done, we'll go ahead and take communion together once everybody gets it. Here you go, Dwayne. Thanks.
We wrote a song as a band, and it's based entirely on worshiping Christ and Christ only. Today in our study, before we started practice, we were talking about pursuing Christ. And I used to hate that term, because to pursue something suggests that something you're pursuing is fleeing from you, that it's running away. So I hated that term. And there's a song that we've sang before called Relentless Pursuit. And honestly, I didn't like the song because of that. But I realized last night as I was studying that we do have to continually pursue Christ. And not because he's running away from us, but because due to our nature, we will tend to run away from him. If we are not consistently pursuing Christ, making him the focus of our lives, making him the only thing that we worship, we will naturally tend to fall back away from him and fall back into our nature, which is the total opposite of Christ. As we were talking about it, we kind of compared it to riding a bicycle up a hill. And life is this hill, because life, you know, Satan is the prince of this world. He's always going to have something else to throw at you, something else to slow you down. So if you picture riding your bicycle up this hill, if you stop pedaling, guess what happens? You start rolling backwards. And the picture that comes to my mind, we used to live in Pennsylvania, and there was this street right at the end of our block. And we were on like a glorified hill, I guess you could call it a mountain. And this street called Wabash Avenue, I mean, it was like this. So steep that in the winter, we used to take laundry baskets and slide down the street. But the trick was, before you reached the intersection, you had to dump out of the laundry basket because it was a major intersection.
Oh my God.
So I just think of this street and riding the bicycle up this street. And just if I stop pedaling, I'm gonna start rolling right back down, and eventually I'm gonna reach that intersection and get clobbered. And that's all it takes. Just stop pedaling, right? The world's always throwing something at us to try and stop us from pursuing Christ, but we have to keep pedaling, keep pursuing Christ, keep pursuing only Christ. This song is called Only to You, and this is all about worshiping Christ and only Christ.
Only to you I give my
rise to our feet. Sing this chorus one last time. Sing only to you.
Only to you I give my worship. Only to you I give it all. Jesus be glorified, be lifted high. Only to you I give my worship. Only to you I give it all. Jesus be glorified, be lifted high.
Amen.
Don't lose that loving feeling. He's given us a new song to sing. Praise Him for it. He's the one and only King. The King of Kings. The Creator of the heavens and earth. Although He owns all things, including you, willing to die that you might live. That's what we're going to remember right now. So this reminds us here, this bread, this reminds us of His body that was broken. Take it in remembrance of Him. The juice reminds us of His blood that was poured out to pay for your sin. Take it in remembrance of Him. I'm going to ask the band to just play that chorus one more time. And if you just love Jesus, if you just love Jesus, and you just want to lift Him up high, lift Him high. Sing. He gave you a new song. This is a new song. This is literally a new song for your mouth to sing. Sing to Him, okay? Let Him hear you.
And sing only to you.
Only